Good morning, everyone. Welcome to church today. So glad you're here and thankful for this opportunity to gather on this beautiful Sunday. The choir is going to start with a chorus, a simple chorus. You are my all in all is the name of the chorus. And I want you to listen well because we're all going to join in and sing it after they're through singing this chorus together. And isn't it true that the Lord Jesus, if you have him, you have everything?
Yeah.
And we might not have all we want in this world, but life gets better when we realize that he is all we need. And often trials teach us that. So the choir is going to sing, "You Are My All in All." And then we'd like to invite you to join us afterwards and sing it with us, okay? This, the words are on the screen. It's not in our books, but we'll have the words up here on the screen for you so we can sing it together. Are they available back there? Let's sing it all. You are my strength. Here we go now together.
You are my strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I seek. You are my all in all.
Good, now seeking you.
Seeking you as a precious.
Together to sing our praise, to encourage our hearts, to learn the Word of God, to be helped and sharpened one another, to, Lord, we want to become more like Jesus, our Savior. And this is part of that process for us as gathering and looking to our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for this morning. And thank you for all that have gathered. We have prepared ourselves this morning. We got up early and prepared our bodies and prepared our hearts for this time. And Lord, I pray that you would use it for your glory and to make us more in the image of Jesus, our Son, and more your Son, and more able to serve you with the time and energies that we have. We love you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Please remain standing. We'll sing some congregational songs together.
Amen. Jesus Christ is our all in all. Amen. Amen. Let's sing about great, so great a salvation. I love the chorus of this song, 431. Life is now sweet. My joy is complete, for I'm what? Saved, saved, saved. 431. Join me, please, from your heart as we sing to the Lord. I found a friend who is all to me. His love is ever true. I love to tell how he lives in me and what
by his power divine.
you, young people. Great song. They do a great job. Amen. Oh, our sins are many, but praise God for his grace and his mercy. For by grace are ye saved, something we don't deserve, but God grants us his grace and desires to save us all. Amen. All right, let's sing another congregational. 411, if you'd like to stand with me, please. 411, I have a message from the Lord. Hallelujah. It is only that you look and live. 411, not 911. 411. Join me, please, now. I have a message from the Lord. Hallelujah. The message unto you.
What a great Sunday morning crowd. But look around, it's wonderful. So many faces we haven't been able to see in a while. It's good to see you back. And you remember in the Old Testament, the children of Israel were bitten by serpents and they were dying. And they said, Moses, what are we going to do? Moses said, I'll go talk to God and find out what to do. And Moses came back to the people and said, God has a plan. And he raised up the serpent on a rod in that wilderness and said, God said, whoever looks will not die, but they'll live. And I'm saying, here we are many years later, but there was a man lifted up on a cross. His name was Jesus. And if you want to live, if you want to live and be free from your sin and have eternal life and be redeemed, the only way is to look to Jesus and you'll live. Don't look to yourself, you'll die. Don't look to the preacher, you'll die. Don't look to the church, you'll die. You look at Jesus and be saved and you'll live. Praise God for sweet salvation, amen? When we sing these songs, we're not sort of like trying to show off. We're saying to the Lord, we believe that just a look toward Jesus Christ, a look of faith is what saves. So let's sing this last verse from our heart today. You're doing so well. Good to have you, Brother Pat. Let's sing verse number 4 of this great song.
Number 4 now.
I will tell you my King, hallelujah. Since Jesus, when he made me whole, to us believing on his name, hallelujah. I trust in him, save my soul.
Amen.
Look and live, I'd rather live. Look to Jesus now and live.
Our order of service just a little bit today. We'll sing again. We have another special also this morning. But if you did not receive one of these last week, if you weren't here last week, just slip your hand up and one of our ushers will be through the room in just a moment to give one of these to you. We announced last week, last Sunday, we announced that this spring and summer we're going to break ground on our new building. And if you've been part of our church for any length of time, some of you have been here for many, many years, and it has been something that's been on our heart for a long time. And if you look around today, you could tell we need it. We need more space. And we've been praying and asking the Lord on when to start, when should we go, when should we do it. And certainly we have received the green light from him to go ahead and do it this year. Not everything's in place, but we're trusting God that he'll put it in place. And that's the way faith works, is that you say, how are we going to pay for it? Well, God will give us what we need to get it done. That's the way it has always worked. I remember when I was a young man, by the way, just slip your hand up if you did not get one of these. The ushers would come by and put one in your hand if you'd like to have one. But when I was a young man, someone said to me, and I was, you know, I didn't really know much about, you know, Bible things. And they said, you need to focus on being a good steward. And so I was confused. I wasn't really sure what that meant. So I looked up the word steward in the dictionary, and it said an attendant on an airplane. Well, that doesn't sound right. But then I began to learn that being a steward is a huge Bible truth. Really, a steward is one who handles. And I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, if you're saved now, if you're not saved, there's a whole other world of things you need to know about, and that's trusting Christ as your Savior. But if you are a Christian, if you're born again, one of the greatest truths you'll learn is that everything you have and everything you are is his. And it's our responsibility here to handle it well for his glory. To be a steward. You know, when Adam was created and placed in the garden, whose garden was it? It was God's garden. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. This is all. Nothing has changed since then. You and I are stewards of God. Everything we have is his. Every breath I breathe is a gift from God. Every day I wake up is a day he allowed me to wake up. Every day I have strength in my legs and strength in my arms is a day that he gave me the strength in my legs and the strength in my arms. Every dollar in my wallet, every vehicle in my driveway, every room in my house belongs to him. They're all his. And I want to be a good steward of all he's given me. And I want to use it for his glory. I want to read a scripture to you. We have two of our folks who are going to be able to speak this morning and say a few words about our building program and the need. But I want to read to you. You don't have to turn there. It's just a few short verses. He that is faithful in that which is least is faithful also in much. And he that is unjust in the least is unjust also in the much. If therefore ye have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust true riches? Jesus said, if we have not proven ourselves to be a good steward of the little things, of the things that really don't matter. And here's the honest truth, money in the end isn't going to matter. Ask someone who's close to dying, ask them if money matters. And I promise you, they'll say it doesn't. In the end, money doesn't matter. But I know that there are things in this life that are more valuable than those kinds of riches. And the Bible says if we are faithful, unfaithful in the, if we have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust those true riches? You know, one of the things I'm excited about with this building program and the fact that we're all going to be able to give and prove God is that I believe God is going to give us blessings, tremendous blessings, out of the sacrifice and the giving and the adventure of faith. I believe God's going to give us those great blessings that are sort of like the kind of riches that only God can give. The kind of thing that only comes from him. Look, you can get money from an employer. You might be able to get health from a bottle.
But there are some things that only God can give, and those are the true riches that God looks at regarding our stewardship. I am so proud of our church. We've saved a lot of money and put a lot of money away for this project. There's still some more to be given. I talked to the Lord even this week. I said, Lord, where is all the money going to come from? And where is it? And God doesn't speak to me audibly. He doesn't speak to anybody audibly. He speaks to us through his word. But the Holy Spirit sometimes impresses things on our heart. And it's as if the Holy Ghost said to me, he said, don't worry, I'll make sure the people have it to give. And I believe God, don't you? I believe God. And it's exciting to be able to step out in faith. It's not often you get to get out of the boat and walk on water. It's not often that you get to really practice some big faith, but this is one of those times when we get to practice it, and it's going to be fun. It really is going to be fun to see what the Lord is going to do. Some of us decided last week we're going to give our stimulus money to the building fund. And then I started getting convicted when we had agreed to that, my family and I thought, I went back to David. Remember David who was wanted to offer something to the Lord, and somebody was going to give him something that he was going to make an offering. And then David said, I don't want it because I don't want to give God something that costs me nothing. And then I had guilt this week when I was thinking about that I'm just going to take money from the government and pass it on. And I'm thinking, well, that doesn't really cost me anything. And I don't know what the Lord's going to do. I know he's going to do great things among us. We need the space. This morning, people were trying to find a corner anywhere in this building to practice music. And some of us went out to the Moslers to practice music. And we need the space. And God's going to walk us through this, and it's going to happen. It's going to be wonderful. It's going to be amazing. And I'm excited for the spring and the summer and the start. I have two men that I've asked to say a few words. Why don't we start with Brother Bob? He'll come up and say a few things. And then Pastor Matt, you'll be next. And if you would have the ushers come forward before you finish and say a prayer for the offering too. We'll have the offering at this time. Brother Bob.
Well, as usual, Pastor put this on me right this morning. No time to prepare.
Amen.
So I'm going to tell you just real quickly. When I first came to this church, it was on a Saturday morning. I went to men's Bible study, prayer breakfast, and that was the first time I ever stepped foot into this church. So I walked through the doors back there, and I'm kind of nosy. I looked in, I could see it was the pastor's office there. And he used to have a sign above his desk, and it said, where there is no vision, the people perish. And, you know, ever since I've been here, there's been, building plans and that kind of thing. And you all allowed me to be one of your deacons. And it's been a great honor and privilege to do that and to serve with and for you and that kind of thing. But I'm going to tell you, we go to the deacons' meetings and Pat and Matt and all the deacons and everything, and we really do pray over these things. And I wanted to read you just a quick verse. I'm not preaching. Okay. For which of you intending to build a tower sitteth not down first and counteth the cost, whether he have sufficient to finish? So I'm kind of a financial guy, business. I'm a chemist by trade, but I looked at this thing and we have about half of what is necessary to do this building. So, you know, I'm counting the cost. I'm reading scripture. And then I got to thinking, you know, Jesus Christ is able to give us all our needs. our needs are many, as it turns out. I read all the statistics about a church. You know, if it's not 80%, if you got to have at least 20% of the church open to bring more people in. Otherwise, you all Americans get uncomfortable. So, I thought, wow, isn't this something? And there's a million jokes about this going around the church. The government all of a sudden gives everybody money. I'm like, yes, indeed. God does supply. Nancy Pelosi. We won't dedicate a building to her, but here's the thing. We have counted the cost. Because I'm going to tell you something. Jesus Christ will supply our needs.
Yes, amen.
And you know, you have to go ahead and do things sometimes. And the Lord impressed it upon the pastor's heart. And I'm just going to impress upon you all that we get behind our pastor and follow him. He's your pastor. Believe it or not, that's our duty to follow that man. He's the pastor that the Lord has given us. And we need to follow him. And I'm going to tell you, I think there's nothing like a project like this to bring unity within the church. Unity is a very important thing. It is the number one thing within a church that God wants to promote. And so Jesus Christ is the reason that we ought to be giving. There's a lot of things we could say. We need music rooms and that kind of thing. We need a place for a lot of different classrooms, that kind of thing, things that are planned, Bible Institute, that kind of thing. We got to have room for that stuff. I'm going to tell you right now, the biggest reason to give is to give as unto the Lord. And the Lord will bless you beyond measure. As stated in Sunday school, he will not leave you nor forsake you. Now, this is a big, big project. But we have a big, big God.
Amen.
And my God is able, your God is able. So I'm just asking you all, let's just pull together, give what you can. Stimulus is a great start. But like Pastor said, that costs you nothing. Your government's giving it to you. Because I get it. You're going to pay for it down the road. You know what? Whilst we have some money, let's put it into a place where it'll do some good. And go forward. And, you know, you could say all the nice cutesy things, build it and they will come. No. Build it and we will use it.
Amen.
And that's the way that we ought to be. So, that's it.
Thank you, Bob.
Praise the Lord. God is good, isn't he?
Amen.
He's wonderful. And just seeing what God has done in this church family with the people here, the power of God that is present here, and the preaching of God's word, and the teaching of God's word, and being with brothers and sisters in Christ, the time that me and Jennifer have been here, and people that I know that were here before, the history of this church, some members that are here, and people that are here that were here when it was Emmanuel Baptist. But what God has done in this church is wonderful, with Pastor and his family and his wife, and this church family here. We've seen the power of God present here.
Amen.
You know, when you come here, we learn about Jesus Christ. We preach about Jesus Christ. And what Pastor is doing is doing what God has commanded us to do in the first place. To go into the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Teach them to observe all things whatsoever I command you. And lo, I'm with you always, even unto the end of the world, Jesus said. We're doing what God has called us to do. And Jesus said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it.
Amen.
Jesus will build his church. And we, as we have faith in God, he tells us to have faith in him in the book of Mark. Have faith in God. And as we have faith in him, as we do what he's called us to do, we can take those steps of faith and we can see God do a wonderful work. We can see the power of God. The world needs to see Jesus Christ. Amen. We need to show the world Jesus Christ. We're here to glorify God Almighty. This church glorifies him. The building that we're building isn't, it's not the building that's going to glorify God, but it's the people in that building that glorifies God. The power doesn't reside within the building itself, but with the people, the church, the people. And God is empowering us as his children to do his will through his Holy Spirit. And he's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we ask or think according to the power that worketh in us. The power that worketh in us, the Holy Spirit of God in us. And God is doing a wonderful work here. So happy for our pastor and what he's doing and the direction he's leading us. In these times, the world needs to see the power of God. Amen.
Amen.
You need to see the power of God in our lives as we follow him, as we proclaim to the world that there's hope, but only in Jesus Christ. We praise God for our pastor and for this church family and for what God is doing here. Amen. And what he's going to do. It's exciting. It's exciting to see what God is going to do and to be a part of it. It's so wonderful to be a part of it because God owns everything, as the pastor already mentioned. All this belongs to him. We're to take what he gives us and through faith, glorify him.
Amen.
Glorify God with our lives, with everything that we have. We're so excited what he's going to do here, and what better could happen, but he can come again, amen? He can come again. He is coming again.
Amen.
We just praise God for his promises and what he's going to do as we look to him in faith, as we give in faith, because it belongs to him anyway. Let's see what God's going to do. Let's hold God to his word. Let's give ourselves. But most importantly, let's give our hearts to the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's do what we've been here, what we've been called to do. Be about our Father's business, telling people about Jesus Christ and encouraging our family in the Lord Jesus Christ. As we see this church family build and what God is doing here, it's just a result of what God promised he would do. Amen?
Amen.
And what he's going to do. We have our ushers come forward this time and we'll receive the offering. Caleb, could you lead in the prayer for the offering, please?
Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you today, Lord. I thank you for the opportunity we had to come here this morning, Lord. Lord, we thank you for everything you've given to us, Lord. Lord, just please, we thank you for Pastor's direction, Lord, as he's leading us to go on with this building, Lord. Just for our faith in you with this, Lord, just thank you so much for that, Lord. Just please bless us all for you.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. I thank you, men, for being able to share those things from your heart. And we'll have some others in the weeks that are upcoming who will also be giving a testimony for us. I just share with you my philosophy. Not every church has the same philosophy. Not every preacher has the same philosophy. I believe the Bible backs up what I'm about to say, is that the church, these plates that are being passed around, free will giving, that's the way the church has always been supported. Is by the giving of God's people. We don't charge for anything. We've tried very hard not to charge for anything. This ESL class that we're starting, we were speaking about the class, and there's a book that needs to be given to each student. I told them, we'll buy the books and give them to the students so that we can talk to them about the Lord. And this is God's way for the church to be supported by the giving and the generosity and the contribution of the Lord's people. And it has been that way since the time of David and Moses and through the New Testament. And so we are here today. Thank you for giving and participating. We're looking forward to a first fruits offering on Easter Sunday, which is the 4th. I'd like for all of us just to consider and plan and pray how we can participate in that offering in a large, big, sacrificial, fun way, how we can participate in that offering on April the 4th. And then also to turn in those cards on a commitment on what you can give for the 3 years that we plan to do this building. I was talking with some of the individuals about going forward with this process. And when I talked with those that were doing the steel, they told me, well, the price of steel is way through the roof. And then I asked about the lumber cost, and they said, well, the lumber cost is way through the roof. And then again, I started to say, Lord, how come? How come the steel prices through the roof and the lumber prices through the roof? And then I started to think, well, will the crowds even come back? And I look out at this crowd today and say, thank you, Lord, for allowing the group of believers to return. God will take care of it all. We don't live on this economy. Thank the Lord we live on His economy, and His economy always works. We don't have to look to Wall Street, praise the Lord. We look to the Lord, and He takes care of His own. When there's a famine in the Bible, He took care of His own. When they were wandering in the wilderness and they couldn't go buy shoes, God said, don't worry, I'll make your shoes last. And they couldn't buy clothes, couldn't go to Target. Well, their clothes didn't wear out. We live on God's economy, not our own. Amen, brothers and sisters. And God will take care of it. He's going to do it all. And I just want to enjoy the fun of participating in with the Lord. So it's going to be a great time. We got another special. Let's have another special now. And then we'll do another congregational and one more special. Great. Let's do it. That's the plan. Special congregational special. All right.
The God who made the mountains, the God who formed the sea, gladly took flesh upon Him and gave His life for me. I stand in awe
of Your mercy.
I'm amazed
by Your grace.
I will sing
goodness till the earth is filled with Your praise.
I stand in awe.
The God who colors creation and gives life to man sees all that You're facing as part of His plan. I stand in awe
of Your mercy.
I'm amazed
by Your grace.
I will sing
of Your goodness
till the earth is filled with Your praise.
I stand in salvation and sees a sparrow fall, offers life eternal to anyone who calls.
I stand in awe
of Your mercy.
I'm amazed
by Your grace.
I will sing
of Your goodness
till the earth filled with Your praise.
We stand in awe of Your glory. We want to worship You and give You all the honor that to Your name is due.
We stand in awe.
Mercy, His grace, His love, His salvation. Praise God for His salvation. All right, let's sing one more congregational, and then we're going to be favored by a duet. Hymn number 2. There's coming a day. Jesus Christ is coming. It's going to be worth it all, folks. I guarantee, I promise you that, based upon the Word of God. Number 2. When we see Christ,
Oftentimes the day seems long.
Our trials hard to bear. We're tempted to complain, to murmur and despair. But Christ will soon appear to catch his bride. As our last, sometimes the sky looks dark with not a ray of light. We're tossed and driven on, no human help in sight. There is one in heaven who knows our deepest care, and let Jesus solve your problem. Just go to him in prayer. It will be worth it all when we see Jesus. Amen. Life trials will seem so small when we see Christ. One glimpse his dear face, all sorrows will erase. So bravely run the race till we see Christ.
And we say amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Faith and Caleb are going to share a special right now.
Almighty God, the great I am, immovable rock, omnipotent, powerful, awesome Lord, victorious warrior, commanding King of Kings, mighty conqueror, and the only time, the only time I ever saw him run is when he ran to me. He took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said, "My son's come home again," lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes with forgiveness in his voice. He said, "Son, do you know I still love you?" He caught me by surprise. He brought me to my knees when God ran. The day I left home, I knew I'd broken his heart, and I wondered then if things could ever be the same. Then one night I remembered his love for me, and down that dusty road ahead I could see it was the only time, was the only time I ever saw him run. And then he ran to me, he took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said, "My son's come home again," lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes with forgiveness in his voice. He said, son, do you know I still love you? He caught me by surprise. He brought me to my knees when God ran. So ashamed, all alone and so far away. But now I know that He has been waiting for this day. I saw Him run to me. He took me in His arms, held my head to His chest, said, my son's come home again, lifted my face, wipe the tears from my eyes with forgiveness in His voice. I felt His love for me again. He ran to me. He took me in His arms, held my head to His chest, said, my son's come home again, lifted my face, wipe the tears from my eyes with forgiveness in His voice. He said, son, do you know I still love you?
Faith, would you play that song a little bit more? Caleb, stay up here. How many know that story of the prodigal son? Yeah. Right? Your prodigal son, Luke chapter number 16. There might be some people here this morning. You've come into church, but you've been running from God for a while. And we know this, that story, the father is an example of our Heavenly Father. No question. Look, if you want to get back to the Lord, you don't have to run to Him. Usually you can't. Sin in the world has messed you up too much. All you've got to do is turn, and God will get to you. All you got to do is repent, just change, just say, I'm done. I'm done with the world and sin and life and I want to turn to the Lord Jesus Christ, and He will come to you, but He won't come until you turn. It is unusual for a dad to run, isn't it? Us old guys, we can't run much anymore. We had some roller skating yesterday, Danny's birthday, and I got out there on the rink, and it was nerve-wracking to be out there. The bigger they are, the harder they fall. We get older, we don't do things like that much anymore. But I'm glad that God still runs to the repentant sinner and embraces them and says, I love you. Welcome home. Welcome home. It's not hard to come back to the Lord. He does it. We just have to turn to Him. That's it. There may be some of you here, you've got a son or a daughter, a grandson, a granddaughter, a spouse, a loved one, someone who has walked away from God. They've walked away from God. You say, what needs to be done? All they've got to do is turn. We could pray that they turn, because if they'll just turn, God will come running toward them and embrace them again. I thought we'd just take a little time to pray for loved ones, for someone we know. If there's someone here this morning that maybe your life has been distracted at best and at worst wrecked by sin, why not turn back to the Lord today and come? Come back to Him. Come back to Him. He loves you. He loves you deeply. And He'll wrap His arms around you and welcome you home. Welcome you home. You say, well, after all I've done, doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. He'll welcome you home. So just a time of prayer. If you want to use the altar to pray, I'll be here if someone wants me to pray with them. But maybe not the whole song, maybe just that middle chorus or so and into the end of the song. They'll sing a little bit more. But let's all bow our heads and pray and talk to the Lord. Pray for someone. Thank God that He ran to you and embraced you and welcomed you home. But let's just have a time of prayer today.
Day I left home, I knew I'd broken his heart. I wondered then if things could ever be the same. Then one night I remembered his love for me. Down that dusty road ahead I could see was the only time. It was the only time I ever saw him run. Then he ran to me. He took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said, my son's come home again. Lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes. With forgiveness in his voice, he said, son, do you know I still love you? He caught me by surprise. He brought me to my knees. When God ran, I saw him run to me. I was so ashamed, all alone and so far away. But now I know he's been waiting for this day. I saw him run to me. Took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said, my son's come home again. Lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes. With forgiveness in his voice, I felt his love for me again. He ran to me, he took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said, my son's come home again. Lifted my face, wipe the tears from my eyes. With forgiveness in his voice, he said, son, do you know I still love you? He ran to me when God ran.
Father, thank you so much for this morning, and we utter this prayer today, thanking you for being willing to embrace sinners like us and love us and forgive us. And we pray also indeed for some that we care about deeply, that sin in the world has grabbed hold of, and destruction, sin is so destructive. And when we walk our own way, it is a way of traps and snares and self-inflicted harm. But Lord, I pray that if there are some here under the sound of my voice that need to come back to the Lord, that need to rededicate their life, that have been born again but have chosen badly and poorly, that they would remember that there's a God that loves them deeply and embraces everyone that returns in faith. So we pray this today for all the names that were called out in prayer here just a moment ago. We leave them at your feet and trust you completely. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, church family. Thank you for those that do the music. I also want to thank you for those young men that work the sound booth in the back. And the words don't just magically appear up there. They have to be prepared and put together, and then they do that and take care of the microphones and do a wonderful job. Thank you, men, for all that you do back there. And also the YouTube and the Facebook, it goes out through those means so people can watch at home who cannot make it. And thankful that you do all that too. Amen. Luke chapter number 23, we're going to spend a few moments in the Bible today. I know that the hour is a little bit late. Here it is, almost 12 already. But I want to preach on the 3 hours of darkness, 3 hours of darkness. And I promise I will not abuse the time today. I want to give the Word of God the just amount of time, but I will not abuse it. I pray that the Lord will help me to allow each word to have great value. Luke chapter 23 and verse number 44. Just a few verses to read, not many. The Bible says in verse 44 of Luke chapter number 23, "And it was about the sixth hour, and there was a darkness over all the earth until the ninth hour. And the sun was darkened, and the veil of the temple was rent in the midst. And when Jesus had cried with a loud voice, he said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And having said thus, he gave up the ghost." We have been here in Luke 23 for several weeks. We've been around the cross, and it's good for us to be around the cross. It's good for us to re-examine this and examine it in depth. This event that we're reading of, the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, it is the pivotal point of all that is to be known. It's the pivotal point of human history. Everything that you need to know is secondary to this knowing that Jesus died on that hill that day for the sins of the world and for yours. It is the center of human history. And this event that is recorded for us in the Word of God, none of us were there, but it's recorded for us in the pages of the Holy Bible, and it is full of meaning. Everything that is there that's happening around the cross is so full of meaning. Every word that is spoken is filled with such grace, glory, and truth. And Luke records for us, as well as Matthew and Mark, all record that for 3 hours, everything was dark. Now, the Bible says it was the sixth hour to the ninth hour, and in our daily hours, that would equal noon until 3. So from noon until 3 o'clock, on the day Jesus died, the Bible says there was darkness over all the earth. That's an important point. It's an important point that it was dark for those 3 hours. There's much teaching and learning in the 3 hours of darkness. There's things we must consider and understand, and the first thing I want you to consider is the miracle of it. The miracle of it. You say, what is a miracle? A miracle is when God operates outside of the ordinary laws and rules. You know, this world was created with rules and order. And the rules and order that God put in place here, you and I are subject unto in every way. We are subject to the rules and the order of this world. God is not subject to it. God is the creator of it. Now, many times he, in his own choosing, operates inside of the rules that he has placed here. But miracles is when God chooses to operate outside of the rules and the order that he has placed here. And there are some people that deny the existence of God. And by the way, that group is growing. The atheist group is growing in our country. And I can understand an atheist not believing in miracles. There are even some who say they believe in God, but they try to explain every miracle by natural means. They try to put some kind of explanation in there. Well, it probably was a lunar eclipse, or it probably was, you know, and the children of Israel didn't cross the Red Sea, they crossed the Reed Sea, and the Reed Sea is only a few inches deep. And so they try to explain every miracle through some kind of natural means. And I want to say, if you believe in God, then you should believe that God can do miracles. He doesn't have to operate in this world, these things. He doesn't have to operate under these laws that he has put in place. God's above those laws. And so I'm not going to explain this darkness by some natural means or that it was astronomy and there was some movement in the heavens of some things that were just in place and the timing was perfect. I believe God did something supernatural that day. Unexplainable. Unexplainable by any astronomer, unexplainable by any scientist, unexplainable by any geologist. No one can explain what God did this day in that darkness except for that it was a miracle. And I believe that God can do that. I believe God operates outside of those established rules. God had operated outside the established rules when he took Elijah up to heaven in a chariot of fire. You try that. Gravity keeps us down. God said, I'll use a chariot made out of fire and bring my man up. God operates outside of the realms of normal order when those three Hebrews were thrown in a fiery furnace that was so hot it killed the people throwing them in. And God said, I'm going to protect them in that fire. And so much so that when they came out of the fire, the king said, I don't even smell smoke on their clothes. Because God can operate outside the realm of normal rules and order. God doesn't have to fit inside a medicine. He doesn't have to do normal procedure. God can give a blind man sight by spitting on the ground and making a little mud and putting the mud on the eyes. And when he washes it off, he sees. Because God can operate outside of the rules when he chooses to. We talked a little bit about this not long ago, that God can operate outside of the normal rules when Jesus went on that boat and just went like this and said, peace be still. The wind ceased and the waves stopped at his voice because God does miracles. And I wanted to say this. I pray that if you believe in God, you believe in miracles. I pray that every Christian can look at some times in their life when God worked outside of normal rules. When you lost your job and you shouldn't be able to pay your bills, but after 24 months you look back and the bills are paid. How does that work on paper? It doesn't work on paper, but God can operate outside the rules. Or when the doctor says, we've seen this kind of cancer before and it is terminal, and God chooses to give you extended life. God can operate outside of the rules and the laws which he has put in place. And this is what happened that day. The darkness for 3 hours from high noon until 3 was not some explainable thing in the heavens. It was God, in my view, it was God turning off the sun. You ever reach over to a lamp and pull the cord? It was as if God said, I'm turning it off for 3 hours. And God turned off the sun. The Bible says the sun was darkened. And Luke emphasizes it this way, that the sun was darkened over all the earth. That's why Luke records it. The entire earth, darkness, and this whole globe completely. Normally, the way it normally works, God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good. He divided the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night, and the evening and the morning were the first day. But on the day Jesus died, he did something supernatural and turned off the day for 3 hours, from noon until 3. Not only was it a miracle, and I want you to see the miracle in it, but I also want you to see the activity that took place in it. From midday till 3, midday became midnight. And can you sort of put yourself in that scenario when it's not just as if it got dusky? The Bible doesn't say it got dim. The Bible says it got dark. Everything stopped, right? That's normally the busy time of the day. Everybody's busy at noon. And at that hour, when man is normally busiest, everything everywhere, not just in Jerusalem, not just there in that place, but every place, everywhere, every town, every village, every hill, every market, every home, everyone had to stop. The whole earth. Because the Son of God was dying for sin, for us. I believe God wanted some attention. You can't just go about your business, no matter where you lived on this planet, and not know that something was happening. Something huge was happening. Something important was happening. It startled mankind. It startled human beings. They had to grope for a light. No one would be prepared with a light. You would have to grope for a light. And if you were cutting down a tree, your axe will stop in midair because the light went off. And you'd have to think, what's happening? What's happening? Around the cross, we know that they were mocking Jesus. I believe the mocking stopped. When God turned off the sun, I believe the vulgarity stopped. Man was paralyzed by fear, paralyzed with uncertainty, struck with intrigue as to what's happening. I want to say, I can't explain all that happened that day. I can't explain all that was happening on the cross. It was a day of miracles. But in those 3 hours of darkness, when human eyes can't really see, the greatest act ever was taking place. And I want to describe it this way very quickly. The one who knew no sin was becoming sin. And I want to ask you, how does that happen? How does that work? How does someone who is sinless become sin? How does someone who knew no sin become ours? How does God substitute? What does substitution look like? How does that come to pass? How did God work that out? How did Jesus become sin for us? I will tell you that I don't know how it all happened. But during those 3 hours, it was happening. Hidden from the view of human eye, Jesus was becoming your sin and my sin and bearing it upon Calvary. Look, I'm content to believe it even though I don't understand it. You would settle a lot of things in your life, the Christian would, if we realize that we don't have to explain everything. We find our hope in believing it. I don't know how God can forsake God. I don't know how the Father can turn his back on the Son. I don't know how that can happen. I don't know why and to what extent it would be fulfilled. But during those 3 hours of darkness, it was happening. And during those 3 hours of darkness, Jesus was becoming our substitute. And the scripture is very explicit on this, that Christ also suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death, the flesh, but the quickening of the spirit. I'm saying that everybody saw Jesus crucified, but no one could really see all that was happening that day. You could see nails in his hands and nails in his feet and blood flowing down and hear his words, but no human being can really wrap their head around everything that was happening that day many years ago as Jesus was becoming our judgment for sin. I can see it as best I can with my human perception, and I have found my peace in that Jesus became sin for me. He suffered. One person said, well, he suffered hell. He likely suffered 1,000 hells. We may never know how much he suffered during those 3 hours of darkness. Not enough capacity for us to fully discern the spiritual work that was happening there that day. And I don't want to make light of my sin. And I enjoyed the song that the young people, the kids sang over here. They sang it once before, and I enjoyed it the first time and the second time. Let's not underrate sin. Because if we underrate sin, then we degrade the remedy. Sin is a big deal. Sin is a heinous thing. Sin is against God. We've missed the mark. And because our sin is so great, what Jesus did on Calvary is so great in that he redeemed us. Out of reach of mortal eyes, God is working the miracle of redemption. Now, there was plenty of light until noon for all to see the suffering Savior. And you may not understand everything that happened that day, but God will reveal enough to you that you can trust Jesus as your Savior. I feel like some people believe they have to become a theologian before they get saved. I got saved at 6 years old. And I knew almost nothing of the Bible, except I knew that Jesus died for me and shed his blood for me and wanted to save my soul. There's enough light there to see the suffering Savior. You may not know everything that happened, and I'm confessing that I don't know everything that happened in those 3 hours of darkness, but I know that he became sin for me, and that's enough for me to believe that and trust him as my Savior. The last thing I want you to know is the victory over it. Some say that this darkness, this 3 hours of darkness, was representative of the evil. And I could go along with that. Jesus told Pilate, he says, this is your hour and the power of darkness. This is prior to his crucifixion. And it is true that Satan was opposed to Jesus Christ from his very birth and sought every means and every way to destroy the Son of God. And here at the climax, if we could use that word, the climax of Jesus' sacrifice and his mission of giving his life a ransom for many, certainly darkness would have enveiled him at that time as he is becoming sin for us. And maybe Satan was at play in the darkness, or maybe it represents evil. I will give you that. But if those 3 hours of darkness represent evil and represent sin and represent the oppression of darkness that is upon mankind, I am glad that after 3 o'clock, the light came back on. I am glad that it didn't stay dark. I am glad that darkness didn't win. I am glad that sin is not the victor. I am glad that Satan is not the victor. I am thankful today that Jesus Christ is the victor, and he is victorious over death and hell and the grave. The Bible says it this way: for God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Darkness doesn't win. Light wins. Jesus wins. He is our victor. And he conquered sin, death, hell, and the grave. Amen. Well might the sun in darkness hide and shut his glories in when Christ the mighty maker died for man, the creature's sin. And at the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. 12 to 3 was tough, but 3 o'clock came, and the sun turned back on, and the Son of God said, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And he finished. It is finished. And I say, thank you, Lord, for enduring those 3 hours of darkness so that I can be saved and born again. Can we bow our heads for a moment today? 3 hours of darkness over the whole earth. It got people's attention. It settled down all of humanity. Great spiritual work was happening in those 3 hours, so deep and so great that we can't fully understand it. But when the battle was over, Jesus wins. And therefore, my brother, you and I win. Are you saved? Are you born again? I'm asking if you're a Christian. I'm not asking if you're a Baptist. I'm asking if you're a Christian. I'm asking if you're saved and redeemed and born again. I'm asking if you've gone to the cross and saw the light, eyes been opened, Jesus is Savior, sin rolled away, burdens are gone, redeemed and justified, adopted into the family of the Lord. Are you saved? Are you born again? There's enough light at Calvary for you to see him. There's enough light. Whatever the need is today, we want you to come. If you're not saved, I'm inviting you to come to the front, meet myself or one of our other folks here, a man or a woman, and we'd be glad to share with you and pray with you about being saved and born again. If you're not saved, if you're not a Christian, please do that today. I would never strong arm anyone. I'm not here to twist anybody's arm. Jesus is too good a Savior to pass up. Other Christians that are here, we could thank God, thank Jesus Christ for enduring those 3 hours of darkness. And whatever happened on the cross that day, whatever battle or whatever spiritual things were transpiring, He did it for you and He did it for me. I'll ask for Brother Matt to come and lead us in prayer today, and then we'll sing our invitation song. Will you stand together as we pray, brothers and sisters?
Let's pray. Dear Father, we come before You this morning. We thank You and praise You, Father, for the cross of Calvary, for the shedding of Your blood. Lord, You took our punishment upon Yourself that we deserve, Father. And in turn gave us Your love. You granted us repentance to all those that look to You. We thank You so much, Father, for the gift of salvation. We do pray that if there be any in here this morning who does not know You as their Savior, they don't know for sure that they're going to go to heaven, that they would please, Father, that they would come forward at this time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Brother, heads bowed and eyes closed. It's 157. Brother Pat, would you come and lead us in a couple of stanzas of this song? We're just going to sing a couple stanzas of Jesus Paid It All. It's 157 in the book. As we sing, Christians are singing, Christians are praying. If you have a need and want to pray, use the altars today and come and talk with one of us about being saved. We invite you to do that today.
I hear the Savior say, Thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me Thine all in all. Jesus paid it all. All to Him I owe. Sin and let the crimson stain.
Verse number 2 now. Lord, now indeed I find Thy power and Thine alone can change the leper's spots and melt the heart of stone.
Jesus made it all.
Thank you, brothers and sisters. Please remain standing for a moment. We'll be dismissed very quickly. We've already received our offering this morning. Also, Easter, April 4th, it's going to be a great day. If you desire to join our church, you're saved and been baptized, and desire to join our church by membership, we'll be receiving members on that day, April the 4th, Easter Sunday. Please let us know about that. We have 6, I believe, already that are desiring to join our church. So it'll be a wonderful, wonderful Easter Sunday. If you are saved and never been baptized, and you want to follow the Lord and believers' baptism, we'll have the water ready, and it'll be warm, and I'll be prepared. Please let me know if you desire to be baptized. I want to talk to you about that, make sure that you understand why and how. But one of the great things a Christian can do is go into the water and be buried in the likeness of Jesus' death, raised in the likeness of His resurrection, and you're proclaiming to everyone that you believe in the risen Savior. It's a public profession like no other. And if you would like to follow the Lord in that believer's baptism, please let me know. The other announcements are there, a youth rally coming up. If you'd like to go, sign up. And the other things are there, youth camp is quite a ways off. Several things there, but you can read through your bulletin, okay? All right, let's be dismissed in prayer. Thank you for being here. We invite you tonight at 6 o'clock for our evening service. It will be wonderful. So thank you for being here today, everyone. Father, we bow our heads in gratitude with grateful hearts, because we could not save ourselves. And you have done everything necessary for our salvation. And you accomplished the work. You completed the work. You finished the work. You endured those 3 hours of darkness, enduring our suffering, becoming our sin. And we're forever thankful that you did that, Lord Jesus. I pray that if there's one not saved that will leave this place, that they could not sleep or forget until they have trusted you as their Savior. And I pray that we'll be able to be used of you this week. Give us opportunities to give a track, to talk about Christ, to glorify God, to shine brightly in this world. Lord, we just want you to use us this week. Bring us back for a wonderful Palm Sunday next Sunday.